is a Qian from the Shanghai Advanced Institute of Finance, and he's going to be talking about wealth management products and bank risk in China. Thank you for, you have 20 minutes.
Thanks. Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
All right, great. Thanks very much for having the paper and me at this wonderful conference. So I'm now, after working in the U.S. for many years, I guess I count as a data point. Professor Kirby mentioned yesterday, back in China, this finance institute was actually founded by the Shanghai government. But we claim we run like a U.S. business school. All right, so my co-authors, Professor Yang, is the well-known Tsinghua University. And my other co-author is Viral Acharya, a very prominent finance scholar. But now he's taken the role of deputy governor of the Central Bank of India. So he made sure I have to say the following. The views you hear from me and the views you read from the paper do not represent the views of the Reserve Bank of India. And that's very important because we're going to be evaluating the Chinese central bank's policies. So there's a lot of research on shadow banking. All right, people are not, it's not new to people here. So we're going to try to look at shadow banking in China. One of the differences is that actually, at least the component we're looking at, the wealth, so-called wealth management products issued by banks, it's actually very closely tied to banks on the balance sheet activities. But you know, so there's a lot of literature on shadow banking in the developed markets. Regulation arbitrage is a central theme where institutions try to get around these regulations in doing so, maximize profits. You know, this conference is on China. China's a large economy. It also has a large financial system and also a very large shadow banking. Right? You have different definitions of shadow banking. A broad definition you can think about is anything off the balance sheet of banks can be counted as shadow banking. So there are all kinds of estimates. One estimate from Financial Times a few years back said, in terms of credit, loans, the shadow banking, as I said, off balance sheet of the banks is about 50% of the total loans made by the banks, which is a big number. All right, so we're going to look at the largest component, or one of the largest, which, as I said, these are so-called wealth management products issued by these banks. We're going to have 25 largest banks. We're going to have product-level information and all the banks' information. So here's some very simple facts. So one of the things that's very important to understand this is that banks in China are very heavily regulated, as do banks everywhere else. But in particular, there are a couple of things that are very important. Okay? One is, until the end of 2015, the deposit rates are capped. Okay? So you go to a bank. The bank says, you know, I like you as a customer. I would like to attract you by offering a very attractive rate on your deposit. But there's a ceiling. So basically, there's a cap on how high the deposit rates can be. That's a very important regulation of the banks. Two, very important, there is a so-called thing called the loan-to-deposit ratio. So basically, the regulator says for every dollar deposit the bank takes in, the most they can lend out is 75 cents. So those two regulations are very important, and is sort of the driving force behind a lot of these activities. So here's a graph. So we're going to split the banks, 25 banks, in two groups, the big four. You all know what they are. They are gigantic banks, right? So ICBC, by some estimates, is like the largest bank in the world. And all the rest of the banks, we call them small and medium banks. In fact, in terms of absolute size, they're still very large. Their assets are in the hundreds of billions, tops, to much lower. So it's relative. Relative to the big four who have assets in the trillions of dollars, we call them SMBs. So you can see this line shows deposit over assets for the SMBs, and there's a big drop. Okay? And then on the other hand, this black line, which is the key, the wealth management products over assets, there's a huge jump here in the graph in 2011. So looks like there seems to be substitutes, deposits, and WMPs. And obviously, this is an interesting fact. We're going to try to explain why the sudden jump in these products. And then the type of products you're looking at, again, there are many lines. The key is this black line. That's what we call principal floating. Okay, so these are the riskiest product. That is, the banks will not guarantee even the principal. And these are the products, principal floating, are completely off the balance sheet. Okay, so the nice thing is, in talking about regulation arbitrage, so everything on the balance sheet are regulated. Deposit side, the rates are capped. On the loan side, you cannot lend more than 75% of what you have. Off the balance sheet, though, no such regulations. All right. So the idea is very simple in that by offering these off-balance sheet principal floating WMPs, these banks, especially the smaller banks, we're going to argue, can attract depositors. Otherwise, it's going to have huge pressure from these big banks. So the question is basically, a very important question is, we've already talked about this in the morning and yesterday, we're going to try to link the issuance of these off-the-balance sheet products to the stimulus plan again. And the way we're going to do it is we're going to look at sort of the geographical branching of different banks and the competition. Our regulation arbitrage I already mentioned, so that's a very important question. You're going to see that basically the big four banks and the other banks are quite different. In fact, you know, if you're concerned about the Chinese banking system, basically from our study, everything for the big four banks looks safer. If you look at the on-the-balance sheet stuff, they look safer. If you look at the off-the-balance sheet stuff, they're also safer. So what you really have to worry about are these smaller banks, especially smallest regional banks. These WMPs have potentially substantial rollover risks because most of these products are very short term, 3 months or shorter. And when they get that money, they're going to invest in a lot of long-term projects, including real estate, infrastructure, and so forth. So this is sort of the standard mismatch in maturity. So we're going to look at effects of these rollover risks. We're going to see how they're going to finance, refinance when these products are due. I'm going to have a few more minutes left, so I'll give you a summary of the main findings. So the key here is, the starting point is that the way credit was pumped into the real economy following the stimulus plan was mostly through big four banks' newly issued loans. Okay. So local governments, firms, right? They got a lot of credit. Most of that credit following the stimulus plan was from these big four banks. Basically, the big four banks, controlled by the central government, have sort of the mandate to do that. Okay, so that's a starting point. But interestingly, as we're going to document, among these four banks, Bank of China was the one that was the most aggressive. In other words, they served the order of the party, the most aggressive. Okay? So that creates sort of a nice difference in terms of how these smaller banks, which are mostly regional, so we have all these geography stuff, how as they face more competition, especially from Bank of China, react to that competition by doing different things. So that's sort of our story, and also it's our, hopefully I convince you that's the identification strategy. For people in academia, that's important. Otherwise, we're just trying to establish some causal relations. Okay, so that's going to be an important fact. So we're going to look at the response of SMB. So as these large banks increase loans, sort of that's the stimulus, remember there's the loan-to-deposit ratio. So as you then make a lot more new loans, you have to also raise deposits. Otherwise, you're going to cross over. Okay. So basically, the smaller banks, they have a lot of pressure anyways from these big banks. So as big banks raise deposits to match their loans, a lot of these smaller banks feel increased pressure. What do they do? We're going to show that the way they do this is going to issue these off-balance sheet products because they're not regulated. They can offer higher rates. And when these products do, right, when this money comes back, if the investor is a depositor of the bank, actually this also helps on their deposit side because the money comes back. Okay, one of the key findings is we're going to use this geography information, and we find it is those small medium banks with more geographic exposure to competition, especially from the most aggressive largest bank, BOC, they're going to be the ones issuing the most riskiest type of these WMPs. And then we look at the rollover risks. We look at the yields on these new products. We link that to how much is coming due. As I said, these products are mostly very short term, 3 months or lower. And then we also look at the interbank market to link that to these amounts of WMPs. And finally, out of the 25 banks, 17 of them are public listed. Not a whole lot, but we can look at stock market reaction and then see if the market has some idea with the risk in this. Data, actually everything is public. So for every product WMP issued by any bank in China, basically they need to have a prospectus and that's publicly available. Obviously, if you just go and collect one by one, it's going to take some time. So we got this. We did a lot of these collecting, but we also checked that with the banking regulatory committee to make sure everything is correct. And then we have information on the banks. All right. So a few more graphs. This is just to show you that the upper bound on deposits, for the most part, were indeed binding. All right. So the black line, that's the 3 months deposit rate, the ceiling. Okay, it's cyclical or countercyclical. And the blue line, that's the weighted average yield on all the products. And then the red line, that's sort of the Chinese market rate. That's the Shibor, right, named after LIBOR. And you can see that, obviously the blue line tracks the red line, and the red line is almost always above the black line, that's when it's binding, except for a short period in 09. What happened in 09, that's when the stimulus, maybe there was too much money coming out, and then that dragged down the market rate. Other than that, the deposit rate ceiling wasn't binding. But that's important for regulation arbitrage argument. So this is just showing that for the loan-to-deposit ratio, that's another regulatory requirement. Again, in the earlier part of the sample, you can see clearly smaller banks, they're closer to the bound, 75%. Okay, and that's something that they can be very careful. Nick was just talking about this. So the other thing that's interesting is that, again, you look at the most important channel, new credit has been pumped into the economy, was these new loans, especially medium and long-term loans, 1 year, 3 years, and or longer maturities. So you can see that this is total, right? That's a pretty large increase starting in 08 and 09. Number-wise, it's 66%. So it was a very large increase in the big four banks' newly issued long-term loans. On the other hand, if you look at small, medium banks' long-term loans, there was change, but not as much, much smaller increase. Short-term loans, not a whole lot of change. So the top line basically shows that that's sort of the implementation of the four trillion stimulus. All right, so I'm going to give you a series of graphs just to show you that Bank of China was somewhat different. Okay, this is loan balance. We use quarter 408 as the benchmark, so that's one. All right, so it's like a percentage. So you can see that before the 08 quarter four, Bank of China's loan balance wasn't that impressive in terms of total amount. ABC, that's the Agricultural Bank of China, was much higher. But then you can see this red line clearly shoots up a lot more than the other three lines. That's the first piece of evidence. This is loan balance. This is the LDR, the loan-to-deposit ratio. You can see that post the stimulus, the red line, that's the BOC, BOC's LDR, it was by far the highest. It seemed as though the LDR was also higher in the pre-09 period. So we're going to check, we're going to do some tests to check whether it was pre-trend. That was a nice comment by Kinga at an earlier conference. So we're going to see that whether it was pre-trend. Was BOC already impacting other banks before the stimulus? And the answer is no. This is deposit balance, right? Again, you can see that a bigger jump for BOC after 08. Now, the question is why did BOC act differently? All right, there are many stories, right? You will never read this from the official press, okay? But I'm going to give you some facts with some pictures, okay? So this was Mr. Shougang, right? He was the president of Bank of China during the stimulus period. Okay, there's a background, right? So so as I show you, BOC expanded very aggressively, right? Perhaps as a result of that, perhaps not. At the end of the term of becoming of being the president of BOC, in 2013, he was promoted to the most powerful regulatory position in China, and that is to oversee the stock market. It didn't end very well. He was fired, which was very rare after the stock market backlog in 2015, as Wei was talking about in the morning, and also the circuit breaker that lasted for 4 days. So after that, so it didn't end well, but nevertheless, he got a very nice position. This is Mr. Zhang Jianqing, right, whom actually I interviewed for writing a case on their IPO. He's widely regarded as the professional banker in China, often compared with people like Jamie Dimon, which I'm not sure is a good comparison after the crisis, but nevertheless. So he's a professional banker. Right? He went to London for training in 1978 or something. And if you look at the performance of ICBC, all these years, by far, any metric you look at, was the best among the big four. When I interviewed him, there's another one. When I interviewed him, I asked him that question. ICBC is majority owned by the government. Do you have to, you know, listen to the government? He flat out said, during my tenure, there were two premiers in China. Not one of them or anybody ever called me to put pressure on what I should do. I'm the president of a commercial bank. That's what he said. And performance was great. But after his term was finished, he reached his retirement age, he got no position, not even the insurance agency, right, which was considered the most boring position out there. Nothing. His official title now is the president of a think tank in Shanghai. Right? Without, you know, so maybe we can talk to him more. Right? So, just to put this in perspective, then maybe this has something to do with it. All right, so as I said, our strategies look at these geographical exposure to these big four competition. So the key is this deposit. So the branching of all these banks are very extensive. So basically, the deposit market is very local. Most of the small, medium banks are regional. So again, we argue that shift, that jump by BOC was sort of exogenous to the small banks starting in 09, and that's sort of our strategy. So basically, this is our measure for competition. We have branches information at the zip code level, so we can work out sort of a weighted average of a regional competition measure or a competition measure at the headquarter level. So this is a map of BOC. As you can see, that the darker here's the it's concentrated in Guangdong. Speed up. This is ICBC. Clearly, they're different. So one of the important result is that you can see that before 09, before 2011, that's when you see the spike. The BOC competition, the indicator, has no impact on the other banks. But starting in 2011, that becomes significant. Okay. The pre-trend was due to overlapping Guangdong, and then the key was to reporting to Kinda. As soon as you're putting this bank type fixed effect, it goes away in terms of the effect only coming after 2009. This is results on issuance. Again, you will see that not much in 08 and very strong in 09, starting in 09. This is on issuance, more on issuance. I'm going to skip this. We try to answer why Big Four also increased the issuance, basically to refinance some unfinished projects. Rollover risk, I'll just give you a couple more things, I'll wrap up. So here's a histogram. So as I said, most of these products are 3 months or less. So you can see a lot of these products are due just at the quarter end. Why is that? Two reasons. The LDR, the loan to deposit ratio, are calculated by the banking regulator at the quarter end. So as long as you're good on that day, you're good. Okay? The other thing is, once these products are due, depositors get their money back. They may put that money into their banking account, which boosts deposits. In terms of regressions, we show that the amount that's due in the immediate past has a huge impact on the yield of the new product, right? So they're basically raising expected return on this just to attract more money because they need the money. And then for the big banks, they're getting some of these financing in the interbank loan market. So the big four banks amount due closely tracks the 1 week SHIBOR rates. And then finally, the stock market seems to react to that in a sensible way. That is, they understand, look at the stock price reaction. All right, so I'm going to wrap up. We argued and showed that the 4 trillion stimulus had a causal impact on the issuance, at least of the small, medium banks' issuance of these risky products off the balance sheet. There is a lot of rollover risks. Certainly on the banks and also on the overall financial system. If you're tied to the U.S. or similar to the growth of the money market fund and the asset-backed commercial paper market crash, and I'll stop here. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. The discussant is Zhiguo from University of Chicago.
What's the best way to do that? All right. All right. Good. That works. Thanks a lot for having me here. So I
recently got really interested in these topics. So this is a great paper. I wish I could have written it. So let me go back. I'm here really trying to tell you what this paper about and the telling you a little bit about the caveats around it, and also I want to push you to think about where does those wealth management product go. I think the latter question probably is more important than the previous question. Like, you see a lot of rise, but what we really do not know is where it goes. Okay, so let me just tell you that the wealth management products, here's a little bit of the Chinese character in case you didn't. So I want to emphasize this is a typo. Growing the important part of the ecosystem of the Chinese financial market. I emphasize this is the ecosystem because a lot of things actually surround it based on. In my mind, it's like a Chinese version of a privately manufactured safe asset, which we knew that played a big role in the recent rise of the U.S. crisis and that. Here's a picture that I like to present to you. This is a WMP balance, so that's the red part. What's more important is you have to take a relative ratio to show it's slowly gaining market. So what I did is a WMP balance over total bank deposits. So we knew the US China market is growing, so you think about the total bank deposit is indeed also growing rapidly, but the ratio between these two, so this is like off balance sheet, this is the on balance sheet, is growing from 2% to here is about 18%. So that's a huge growth. Yeah. All right. What caused this rise of WMP? This is a huge growth here. In this paper, this is emphasizing this 2000 stimulus plan plus competition between the big four and SMB. So that has a very nice story about this Mr. Xiao. So basically saying that those small, medium banks in a disadvantage in getting regular deposits to meet the so-called loan-to-deposit ratio regulation. Nowadays, it's actually kind of got the removed, but at that time, was very strict. So as a result, then you just have to offer better rate to attract more money, and all these things. So King now going to present another paper, which kind of aiming on the similar kind of the topic, but I emphasize the change of LDR and the competition. That's another. The other ways to think about what might also what's going on. There's a very interesting variation of BOC. I like, you know, as an academia, you get excited about those things. So you see, this is some gimmick going on, and let's discover what's and document like a detection, detector in these economic activities. So BOC was extremely aggressive in following the central government of Beijing's order. And if you were unlucky that it happens to compete with those aggressive guys, then you're just in trouble, then you had to do a lot of other things. Jin will not put his picture there because for obvious reasons, but I guess that, you know, I thought I'm in US, probably this type of a risk is lower. So I can put the picture here, but you're brave.
Here.
Yes. Oh, you are. So let me just give one picture that this is coming from my own paper, which talk about similar things. But this is the best picture I ever met in my life. Even though that I really not, I'm a theorist, so don't make pictures. But this is something astonishing that when you just plot it. So this is what's good. I was plotting from 04 to 15. This is over about 11 or 12 years about the growth of GDP. So this is the number, GDP growth. And here I'm plotting, this is the red dotted line is a new bank loan, and then scaled by the previous GDP. So those numbers are just comparable. You can see here, this is something here. This is a big bump, and then go on. So after seeing this, you're going to see that a lot. Later on, we're going to experience something different, okay? And what this paper shows that, okay, not only here, we see something interesting, but also later on, also a lot of other things. That so what this paper really kind of like make the all the paper click and also the methodology become very interesting is this, they try to measure SMB banks' heterogeneous exposure to Mr. Xiao's shop, which is the BOC. They have this city level information that's really clever. I wish I could do that. And once you see this point, then it's, whatever they done afterwards becomes super standard in the empirical literature. So basically, if you are competing with the BOC, then the tighter you will become getting tighter because your loan, the loan you try to make is the same, but the deposits gets absorbed by the other guy. So the LDR goes up, you hit the constraint, etc. Then you have to issue more. And what's also more important is that this effect they should only observe after 2009. That was the main click of the evidence. Here's something that, you know, I was reading their previous version as well, and QJ was mentioning a little bit about this pre-trend, etc. It's all just because that, you know, maybe we care this type of thing too much, is that when we try to show you evidence, yeah, we have to rule out a lot of, potential bias, and we have to be careful in interpreting regression results. So ideally, we should include this so-called bank fixed effect for this MB, the SMB, because the point is that, you know, when you run regression, the exposure to different SMB might be different for bank of, let's say, Zhejiang province, which is a really, really rich province, versus the bank of Ningxia, which is, or Xinjiang, it's like, you know, just a totally different bank. Unfortunately, they couldn't, because exposure is quite persistent. That's also why that has become a good instrument, because you can't just immediately move around. This is totally understandable. I'm not quizzing on that. But just saying that you probably try to be careful in control. And they do have a control, and there's some difference result coming out. So that makes me a little bit worried about it. But I feel like I totally believe this story. I was just maybe pushing a bit on making the argument as tighter as possible. So here's the thing. So this is the main result. So on this dependent variable, this is LDR for these SMB banks. And they have 18 or 21 SMB banks. So then this become a cross-section times the panel regression. And then they just do the whole thing. And then here's 07208. You shouldn't observe anything for the VLC here. This, theoretically, you should. The coefficient indeed grows a little bit, but it's not significant. Then you become significant, then it really becomes significant. So here is this bank type of fixed effect here, all these things. So when I'm reading this, but I feel like a CCB, you know, has also a quite negative point here. And so a lot of times that you might think that, okay, you shouldn't only focus on the stuff that you want to focus, right? That's because that's called a bias. You're looking for evidence. You ignore all the evidence that you don't want to see. But I had this concern then later on, like you move on to another one, saying that, okay, let's think about the issuance of equity, then this CCB effect goes away. Which is good, because we try to find a story to explaining all the stuff, right? All the stuff being consistent. So that's along the good dimension. All right. What I want to see, so as an additional thing, that what they were doing is this issuance. We know that the WMP issuance, if you just look at gross issuance, that's very persistent. Just because you need to roll over the same thing. And a lot of times it's just a 1 month type of product. And we knew that this Mr. Xiao, as presented, it's got promoted and left the BOC in March 2013. Okay? So what you probably want to do is, and also what's concerning here, you see that the number become bigger, bigger, bigger. And then the magnitude, it seems like it's very hard to make sense out of this so huge differential. So you might want to do a little bit more on that, and maybe that you calculate the change with WMP issuance and try to see what's going on. All right, so this is the first question. Perfect, great, great. Great question, great methodology. I'm convinced that you just need to fix those things. Question two is about the WMP on banks risk. Then they look at those like window dressing. This is where this, you know, QJ was presenting that a lot of WMP products was intentionally put into mature right before the quarter. Why they want to do this? This is because if you are the principal floating WMPs, which are off balance sheet, okay, if you mature right before, then on the day of the guys are checking on you, do you have enough deposits? It's just those just mature the WMP, which is not deposit at all, become deposit. Because it's mature and is standing there. Right? Then the next day you become another called a WMP, you can earn a higher return. Okay. So that's what they were documenting. That's if you ask any practitioners, they always tell you this story. Okay, so there's no doubt this is what's going on. And they also goes on to talk about this role of a risk in interbank market. And this interbank market is is basically where the banks need to get get those reserve fund type of thing to make sure that they satisfy the reserve requirement. What they were showing is if you have a lot of a big four-dimension wealth management product deal, then there's a lot of a pressure to grabbing the liquidity.
That's good.
All right, so when I'm reading all these things, I don't see really clear connection with the first part here. If you could improve on that, that would be even better paper. So what I want going to the next several slides is trying to put your attention to this interbank market. A lot of people think of an interbank market like in the US is where you get the reserve and try to manage your risk and all these things. In China, interbank market do a lot of things. All these WM wealth management products, they get issued and get all these funds, goes to that market. And those markets basically is like the kind of a, you know that in US we have this proprietary trading desk of these banks, right? And all these in China, these proprietary trading desks are using the WMP issued mud funds and they try to buy a bunch of assets, and those assets are corporate bonds, like short-term notes, or these are commercial papers, blah, 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 all these things. And you could have a very, very strange things that I'm going to show you. All right, so let me just show you that this interbank market grows astonishingly high and large. It's comparable to anything that you might already knew a lot. WMP balance is about that. This is a black line. Okay, it's growing. Okay, but if you look at here's the kind of a pink is a stock market cap. That's where this way wrote a lot of papers on that. Look at this bond balance on this interbank market. It's almost the same. It's the same size. Yet we don't know almost anything about it. Okay. So here's the thing that this is a market that growing like this, and here is a risky wealth management product investment. So starting from 2014, there's an organization, there's an official organization report disclosed that the wealth management product investment in this market. Okay, so here's the ratio that you invested in the here's a credit bond is those corporate bonds that are supposed to be risky that could a default could happen, and in the past 2 years has been a lot of default happening. That's why the Chinese government is pushing this CDS contract, etc. Okay, and here you can see the percentage of investment of the these risky bonds that are invested by this WMP, this wealth management. Okay. And here's a non-standard asset. You're going to feel like, what do you mean by non-standard asset? That's just translation from a very strange name of the China, which is a Fei Biao Changping. Non-standard. What is this? There's loans. Basically, they are loans. Okay? It's the SPV that we had in the US, this special purpose vehicle. On the asset side are loans. On the right-hand side are these, you know, the commercial paper, etc. Right. This is almost my last slide. So this is my last slide, this is the second last slide. I guarantee you this is good. So how do you connect to this WMP to other shadow banking activities? Okay, so WMP here is obviously is a bigger one. There's another way to measure the growth of wealth management product, shadow banking is a trust loans that some people you might know. What is astonishing is that you see this big jump of the loan here, and then later on, you see huge increase of this wealth management product and shadow banking. Now, there's a natural story for it, that this is one of my papers was trying to show that people take a lot of loans here, later on they need to roll over, and they just go to market for it. That's simple. Okay. So this is a final remarks. That's what I'm trying to say, that obviously that we all have shared the same view on 2009 stimulus plan has tremendous unintended consequences, and we slowly start to discover them. And I feel like some of them are good, some of them are bad, some of them are really good. I like this. interest rate liberalization let more market be decisive, in the sense that, you know, the central government found that maybe it's a good opportunity just to get it done at that moment, okay? The barbarian growth of shadow banking is really after 2012. This paper was saying that there's a lot of reason for that. It's because that after 2012, they pushed banks to remove loans to off balance sheet, therefore you just, the banks are doing it. Or what my paper was having is a similar flavor, but from looking at the local government that this morning Shanghai was talking about. Now, what I want to finish my discussion is that the sophisticated interbank market and plus the WMP makes things super, super complicated. Even more complicated than what I ever seen in US market, okay? So the two months ago, there's a huge Chinese bond market collapse, if you read all these news. It's related to the fact that the WMP, those wealth management product, enters some repo transaction as a junior claim. So basically you issue all these WMP, then establishes SPV, those WMP is a junior claim. And how do they borrow? They borrow from central bank by repo, and then invest in those treasury funds. All right, so that's why that those WMPs, they're gonna offer more than what the funding cost, that we think that a 4% Shiba should be the upper bound, because that not only including the financing cost, but also the, So those things that we need a lot of researchers really to figure out what's going on. Thank you.
Thank you, Zhiguo. We're running a little late. Let's just take a couple of questions and then we'll take a quick break.
I hear the term risky with this wealth management product. I don't see the risk element in it, because it sounds better to me. Usually we are worried about like short term, what the deposit has this run feature to it that we don't like. Here it is floating principle. Isn't that something we want to do? I'm just a bit confused about what the big deal is about this.
You're right. There have been very few defaults, if any, on these. The problem for us is the data on the eventual use of this, as Zhiguo was pointing out, was very bad. So we can only know at the beginning what's the category, how much they put in corporate bond, interbank market, stocks, and et cetera. So you're right, for the most part, these are considered very liquid and safe products.
All of these would be
So in some sense, to us, the first order thing was when there's a lot of due. This the rollover risk is really the when you have so much out, and then if there was a credit crunch, which happened in the summer of 2013, that's when this become a really big problem, because you just have so you have to refinance so much.
Yeah, they're SIVs.
They're not demandable.
Yeah, it's 1 month.
1 month.
Maturity, usually. 1 month. And what's more important is that people have the expectation of getting full
principle doesn't really flow.
Where do they get those, buying those WMP? That's on the counter of the big banks. And those sales staff, the way they market those WMP, is saying, look, it's safe. Even though I am not allowed to say it, but I'm guaranteeing you, you're safe. That is really the problem. And you know, in China, the vulnerability, of course, is the top priority on this. So
like statistic defaults, you know, like the ones you've seen, it's almost non-existent. I mean, there are incidences where certainly they cannot guarantee the interest, but you know, everything is set in the contract. It's interest floating. For principal, there, you know, if you read the official press, they're almost never. At least we haven't seen it. But so it's really the, you know, so the best example you can think of is in the summer of 2013 and late last year. Summer 13, the Shibor rate shot up a lot. That's when they were like, I remember Wall Street Journal actually reported a big bank was in trouble.
Today's very good presentations, as well as Zhiguo. One question, one comment. One question, do you know who's holder for those WMP, and can another bank hold this kind of a not the bank's will, because we search the yield, the number of householder. Secondly, I think one minor footnote for identification strategies. This morning, Professor Wei Xiong talked about credit story. Think about demand as credit, supply for credit. A lot of shock during your period about reserve requirement change. We can use this shock to see what happened in terms of credit, supply of credit. Or the demand of credit, as this morning Professor Chang Taixin mentioned about. If they have a lot of distortion, mislocations across regions, can you use this kind of a more demand, more distortions, more demand for your, you know, for the bank to provide this kind of a wealth fund manager products? Thank you.
So again, we don't have good data on the investor side. My guess is both retail investors and institutions hold this. Retail investors hold this. You just heard the story from Zhiguo, a standard sales. So basically, especially for these small banks, they're telling their depositors, say, look, I understand you may trust Bank of China more than us for the unbalance sheet. You know, if the government's gonna bail anybody out, they're gonna bail them out first. But look, this is what I'm offering you. I'm offering you this wealth management product, even though it might be principal floating, but come on, we're a bank. We're not gonna default, so it's safe. So, but I can't tell you like the fraction of this. I mean, we actually have data at the issuance. We can separate into sold to institutions versus individuals. But then even there you're getting this problem in the morning. Like individual could be somebody like Jack Ma, or it could be somebody like you and me. So I can't give you a very good sense on what's the, I mean, clearly they could be different. You might argue that if a product was targeting mostly institutions, maybe the yield will even be somewhat different. But that side of the, so as I said, anything, the data is good on the issuing side. Basically, you get that. Now the question you have is a fair one. I guess what we're saying is, because one interesting about Chinese banks is that the branching is really extensive, all right, including all these very rural areas. So, you know, basically, I guess with the data we can do is we look at the impact on deposits, on LDR. So the argument is that basically these smaller banks compete on both sides of the balance sheet. I guess as long as this data is very at the micro level, I mean, we can do some more, regional tests. For example, near Guangdong, take out some other regions. But that's a fair point.
Can I ask a question about the BOC? BOC is in charge of the massive amount of U.S. foreign reserve, right? So, to what extent that the aggressive behavior you observe is due to the U.S. financial crisis, they may actually have a loss for their foreign investment overseas?
I can't answer that question. All I can tell you that if you look at the history of the big four banks, initially, every one of them did serve a purpose. So BOC was in charge. And even now, I think the foreign currency settlement mostly were done by BOC. But if you look at the domestic loan and deposit market, I think they're the same. I mean, I'm not sure. I don't think it's a big driver.
But even if that is a driver, fine, right? So you need an exogenous shock relative to their story about this WMP.
Right. I'm just saying that the aggressive behavior you find out, you repeat again and again about BOC, to what extent it was due to the financial crisis in United States that caused the loss of the Chinese foreign reserve. That's what I meant. Right. Instead of all
we're
the
running out of time right
they have
now.
Money on the foreign reserves. Interest rates.
Back then, the foreign reserves were actually going up a lot. '07 was 1.5 trillion. And then it went from 1.5 trillion to 4. I guess the problem then was the hot money coming in, especially after the crisis. Right?